Everybody, welcome, 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 welcome to all of you who are up in here today. It's so great to see you all. We're going to take a few more minutes to kind of let people kind of settle in. I know y'all are washing your hands, at least I hope so. So there are people who still need to do that. And we're going to get right into it. So buckle up your seatbelts for our roadshow. We'll give people a few more minutes, then we'll get started, introduce everybody, and we'll start the conversation. So get ready. Oh, by the way, if you have a question, go ahead, put it in the Q&A. Also, you can put it in the chat, and we'll definitely answer questions throughout today and make sure you have all of your questions answered. We got some great, knowledgeable people in the building, well, the virtual building. So we're gonna get to you all of your questions today. So hang in there, be a couple more minutes before we get started.
That I've never been, seeing things that I may never see again. I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again, like a man that gets his, we go down the highway. We're the best of friends, insisting that the world be turning our way, and our way. On the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again. The life I love is making music with my friends. And I can't wait to get on the road again.
Well, if you ever plan to motor west, Jack, take my way. It's the highway, that's the best. Get your kicks on Route 66. Well, it winds from Chicago to L.A. More than 2,000 miles all the way. Get your kicks on Route 66. Well, it goes from St. Louis, Joplin, Missouri, Oklahoma City, looks so, so pretty. You'll see Amarillo, Gallup, New Mexico.
Okie dokie. It is time. We're going to get started. Hello, everybody. Look at us. We got a beautiful panel today, y'all. Well, we're a great guest of folk, and I'm hoping you all are going to have a good time. I think we're fun. I hope you all have fun, and I'm super excited to be a part of this journey, and you all are a part of this roadshow with us. So let's get into it. This is a journey for all of us today. This journey pretty much is how to go through the digital student engagement strategy. We want to help you all with all of that. These are very crazy times, you know, people dealing with pandemics and mess. We want to help guide you through the mess today, and that's why we have this. Today we're going to be talking about communicating with your international students. I have background with international students, but three times as much as I do. We got our boy Marty here today, who is going to definitely help us out through that. So Marty, can you go ahead and introduce yourself to everybody?
Absolutely. Thank you, Kevin. Pleasure to be with you here on Unibuddy's Virtual Roadshow. Had a very long, unfortunately, long career in international education, 27 years plus now since I started at my alma mater, Marquette University in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And it's been fortunate over the last few years to work at five different institutions in the US and the UK, but for the last almost 12 years been in the recruiting sphere, working with Education USA out of the Institute of International Education in Washington, DC, as the marketing and outreach coordinator for the Education USA network. And then since 2014, started my own consulting business, social media and international education consulting, and had the pleasure to work with a number of service providers and universities over the last 6 years. I'm looking forward to many more to come.
Thank you so much, Marty. And I'm happy to say I have my colleague with the good beard, Paul, out here. And if you could introduce yourself a little bit, that would be great.
Thanks, Kevin. My name is Paul Bacci. I work with the University Partnerships team over here at Unibuddy, primarily finding and building those university partnerships. I deal mainly with West Coast schools. So if anyone on the west side of the states, you've probably been getting a bunch of emails from me. I apologize, but I'm happy to have you here.
Thank you so much. And why don't we go ahead and get into it? I know, Paul, you have some questions for Marty. So if you could go ahead and start asking as we go through all of these different things, and everyone, again, you are more than welcome to ask questions at any time throughout this discussion. You are a part of this discussion, and we are here to give you information and give you banter and entertainment. So please go ahead and participate with any questions you may have. Anytime throughout this, we'll be answering them throughout. We will have a little bit of a break for a Q&A as well, and there'll be some interactive stuff coming up too. And there is a chance to win a prize if you want a $50 gift card. So, I mean, who doesn't want $50 in these times, okay? So, Paul, I know you got some questions.
Yeah, of course. Thanks, Kevin. Marty, I'm curious, what has been the number one thing international students have been asking? I guess we'll just jump right off the top with a big overlapping question like that. I mean, this is a recruitment cycle unlike any other before. What have you been seeing as the number one concern of international students?
Great question. And Paul, that question changes from month to month, even week to week, it seems.
Probably hour to hour at this point.
Yeah. And I think for right now, I think the international students, particularly if they're already in the process towards the end of the admission cycle, they're applying for visas or hoping to apply for visas to come and make it here for classes. If their institution is going to be hybrid or fully in person. And those numbers are dwindling by the day, at least by the looks of what's been happening at some major research institutions in the South that are perhaps heavily dependent on football for their revenues or made decisions as institutions to stay open. And that's had an impact on their COVID cases. So for international students, they're seeing all this from the outside looking in and wondering, am I really going to be safe? And that if I'm even allowed in, I should say, and that's part of the larger question right now that international students have been struggling with, because, and not just the last few months, but for the last 4 years, there have been repeated attempts by the administration to put up roadblocks to prevent international students, at least in the rhetoric that's presented, and certainly in reality, that the cause has been to see a decline in the number of new international students over the last 4 years. So international admissions folks, we've been fighting an uphill battle for 4 years, really, to counteract the rhetoric from our political leadership. And that's resulted in some fairly robust movements to against that force, anti-immigrant force that seems to be so prevalent in the government. And that started with You Are Welcome Here back right after the elections in 2016. And that had quite a bit of momentum in the first 2-3 years. And they had all the colleges, that's 300, 400 colleges participating in that campaign, the scholarships that were developed in the second year. So there've been things like that that have been very much positives to show that international students, yes, you're still welcome here, at least on our college campuses and in our communities. Whether the government will openly say that they want you here or not, that's one thing. But I think that's been this isn't the only time that's ever happened in our country's history. There have been periods when post 9/11, when particularly Muslim students, Arab students didn't feel welcome here. It was very difficult for a male from the Middle East to get a visa to come up until 2004-5, when the Saudis started to build up their scholarship programs towards the U.S. So there were periods like this where it was really a question, are we still going to be welcome in the United States? Colleges and universities have always been the ones to kind of fight that battle for international students to be on campus. Certainly State Department has played a large role in that, because they see international education bringing students here, sending our students overseas. That's very much a part of their mission, their public diplomacy mission. And that's been an important piece in terms of federal government involvement. So as far as the questions that students are asking, it's, can I still get in? Am I going to be welcome here, really? Those two have been on and off the main questions I think we've seen over the last few years, but in particular the last couple of months, when there's been so many back and forth in terms of changes in terms of what's allowed as an international student to be able to enter the United States, a new international student.
And Marty, what would the answer be when students are asking those questions to their institutions? What should institutions say? What should the answer be?
That's a great question. And for institutions, this should be a ready part of your arsenal in terms of how you respond to these kinds of questions, because it shouldn't be the first time that you're hearing that, especially if you've been in the game for more than a minute. You realize that international students, and if not the students, certainly their parents, will have that question. And that question of, am I going to be safe there? It's changed over the years as to what they're actually referring to. I was working with an institution in Indiana at one point where the main concern when we thought the student or the parent was asking about safety, they were asking about on campus, physical safety, is it crime on campus, that type of thing. But they were worried about, and we find out after the fact, they were worried about tornadoes because there's been sort of tornadoes that had come through the area recently where our college was. And that definition of safety has changed over the years. After 9/11, as a Muslim student in the United States, as an Arab student, am I going to be safe? And that's a very different kind of safety, targeted because of who you are and where you're from or your religion. We also saw over the last few years with the rise in gun violence in the United States, very legitimate questions coming up from parents at college fairs overseas. Hey, is it safe, physically safe? Is my son or daughter going to be shot while they're a student in the United States? That's a very real concern. As a parent, you'd want that. As a parent, I'd be concerned about that. If that were my son or daughter going to a country that had a lot of incidents of gun violence. So that's a different kind of safety. Now it's a health safety with COVID, because our country has struggled in containing it over the last few months. And there are other countries where many of these students might be coming from, some more than others, that are doing a much better job at containing COVID. And a lot of it is a cultural thing in terms of, in the United States, we have a lot of freedom and a lot of independence, and decisions are made at a very decentralized level, even though the federal government has recommendations through CDC and that type of thing. And the federal government can control travel in and out of the country. This federal government has left it up to the states, and the governors have oftentimes left it up to the counties as to how they individually respond to the spread of COVID-19. And so from the outside looking in again, that's a question that of my safety as an international student. Parents worried about, is my son or daughter going to contract COVID while they're there, because they don't have a lot of trust in how the U.S. has responded as a nation to dealing with this virus.
Speaking of COVID, so we know that institutions are pretty much doing whatever they can, you know, because each institution, each university, each college is doing something different. So in your opinion, what have been some of the best responses to keeping students safe from COVID, as well as other things that are still happening? Because even though there is a pandemic, we still have gun violence. We still have also all of these violent reactions to protests as well. So what have been some good examples, and what are some bad examples? You don't have to name schools, because we don't want to throw them out there like that. But
beat me to it, Kevin. That was my next question.
Oh,
beat me to it.
So please answer for us.
Oh goodness. Well, certainly on the good side, the schools, and what I was talking about this on my midweek roundup today, about examples of schools that seem to have a good grip on things in terms of how to manage this. And you look at what happened for when institutions back in May and June started making decisions about the fall. Early on, you saw the Cal State schools make the decision to be fully online this fall. And what that allowed them to do over the course of the summer, and I'm reading some of the articles about what they have been able to do, is they really focused on classroom experience, or what that looked like in a virtual world, because so many of us had Zoom fatigue after the first couple of weeks. In terms of working with students or taking classes, you certainly got really fed up of 45 minute to an hour lectures on Zoom, and really no chance to really have real interaction with professors and classmates. And what the Cal State system did is they really looked at training teachers and faculty on how to better engage with your classes on a virtual environment, how not to just lecture for 45 minutes to an hour, looking at bandwidth issues for students, international students, but also students in low-income areas in the country that might not have high-speed internet or Wi-Fi in their homes. Well, how do they access the coursework and the content, focusing on reducing bandwidth issues there. You saw them move to making conscious decisions to move to asynchronous teaching, particularly for international students, is a huge help, because for those new international students that are starting at Cal State schools this fall, they're taking everything online. They can't come to the US because of the restrictions that the government's put in place. So as a result, there's still new students at Cal State schools, but they're not physically present, but they're being able to, through their switch at Cal State to more asynchronous teaching, they're able to have the opportunity to not get up at 3 a.m. to take a class, because it's 15 hours ahead being taught, or 15 hours behind in California. So that's been a big plus. They've had time to get it right. And I think that's made a difference for those schools that made the decision early to go online. And I know colleges wanted to be fully in person, ideal world. They thought their states would have a better grip on COVID than they've had over the last few weeks. So they've made decisions after students started returning. Other schools made decisions after students started returning and having parties off campus, as they do. They weren't ready to deal with that. Colleges weren't, and I don't think the largest schools have probably larger numbers, and that gets more of the press. And they're certainly seeing a lot more, particularly as I mentioned in the South, where you have these large schools that have 500 cases 1 week, another 500 the following week, are closing down their in-person, going fully online. You've had other schools that have taken a bit more measured approach that started in person, like Notre Dame. They started in person, and then they had a rash of cases jump up on campus. They went online for just 2 weeks. They didn't send anybody home, but they said, okay, everybody's going to be online for 2 weeks. We'll get our case numbers down, and then we'll reassess and reopen. They're looking to reopen next week or this week even. You have other schools that weren't started yet. Michigan State made the decision to go fully in person. Students weren't back on campus yet, so they were actually saying, don't come at all. If you had a place in the residence halls or in university housing, you're not going to have it anymore. Go home. And that's a, probably the worst reaction I've seen by an institution so far. There may be others out there. But on the positive side, there's also schools, smaller schools, that perhaps have a better control of their other campus communities, that have housing that is perhaps more conducive to single person per room housing arrangements. A colleague at Westland was involved in an event I did earlier this week. She was telling me they've had orientation. They had twice a week testing protocols in place for all their students. They went through orientation, didn't have any positive cases for the new students that arrived. They're doing a hybrid mix of classes. So they did have some international students that were able to make the journey, run the gauntlet, win the Hunger Games, and make it to the United States for classes. But they were able to do that without any COVID cases during orientation week. So that's, I think the schools that are going to manage it best are the ones that had plans in place for a while that were really circumspect in terms of how they address these issues of safety and testing and making sure that the new students that once they arrived, if they had to be quarantined for a couple of weeks, some schools were still doing that regardless of what the CDC was saying. So you would see that happening on campus and having them where they could only leave to get food. That would be the only time they could really leave or get exercise for an hour a day. It's almost like they were in prison, but it was for their good and everybody else's good. So I think those schools that had those procedures thought out and really had the ability to contain situations if they did get out of control in a relatively short order, those are the ones that have seen the greatest success in caring for their communities best.
What have you seen be the impact on international students where the original plan was to be in person or a hybrid of some sort, and then all of a sudden it gets pushed to fully remote again? On short notice, what has been the impact on those international students?
It's a disaster, frankly. I mean, you look at what's happened over the course of the summer, when it's not just students having to worry about what the government's deciding to do in terms of who they're going to allow into the country, either new or returning students. Those rules have changed. It was almost a point where if you weren't in person, you weren't going to have, as a new student, you weren't going to have any chance of coming in. But that thankfully was reduced and walked back to hybrid and in person. But when the schools are making these decisions, that particularly at this late stage in the admission cycle, as an international student, the hoops that you've had to jump through just to get to the point where you're ready to get on a plane and come to the United States, if you have an institution that has all of a sudden, when you think about it, the students paid deposits, they've maybe if they're a first year student, they're going to be living in the residence halls, they've made arrangements, they've done travel. They maybe have a hotel or seeing relatives for a week or two before they come to campus. But they've had to go through a process, and it might be 3 weeks between the time they got their visa and the time they leave to come, maybe only a couple days, depending on when visas were even available in their countries. Because most consulates, U.S. consulates and embassies, didn't start reopening until mid-July. So that's pretty late in the recruitment cycle when typically 4 months out is when students can start applying. That's the earliest they can apply for visas. That would have been usually May, sometime in May. For most schools, it's starting late August, early September. So those students who could have applied earlier, May, June, weren't able to apply to middle of July at the earliest, and in most countries that reopen. And then you think about it, oh, if they applied for a visa at that time, there were issues from students, and when they would go with their initial I-20s, If it didn't say anything about whether their classes were going to be hybrid or in person or online on the I-20, that could cause a problem for them when they went for their visas. They might have to get a new visa and then take that back to the embassy or consulate. And you think about that student that might not live in the capital city or where that consulate or embassy is and physically have to go back and forth potentially two or three times to complete that visa process, just that part of the process, that's significant. And then if they were successful getting their visa, and then because their campus had made the decision, they're gonna be hybrid, they're gonna be in person, that's good, they can make it, they can come through Customs and Border Patrol and then enter. But let's say they get their visa at the end of June or end of July and classes start end of August. If they don't enter till a week before classes start, and in that time, if they were going to say a Michigan State, or if they were going to another school that starts right at the end of August, if they had a visa that was issued on the presumption that they were going to be in person or hybrid. And then they get to campus, or they could get to the border, and in the intervening time between the time they got their visa and the time they arrived at the border, they're now in person. The Customs Border Patrol officer who interviews them when they come through passport control, if they ask the question, and most of them will, because that's their job, they have to ask, well, particularly at this time, how are your classes going to be taught this fall? And if the student says, well, we've just gone online yesterday, that student could be turned around in the airport and sent home, because it's not allowed for a new international student to come into the country if their classes are online only. So that puts the international student in a huge huge world of trouble, really. After all that time, a year or 2 years of preparation to come to the United States to fulfill their educational dreams of studying in the U.S. at a U.S. higher ed institution, gets all shot full of holes at the last minute because the institution made that last minute change. If this had been communicated earlier in the process that this might happen, and this is certainly something I was recommending to colleagues when they're making decisions on in person or online or hybrid, is you got to make that call and make allowances and options for international students to say, hey, and some schools like Johns Hopkins, they made the decision and told their international students a week before they decided to go all online. They were originally going to be hybrid up until mid-July. They made the decision a week before they made that announcement to go all online. They said, new international students, stay home. And it wasn't public knowledge yet that they were going to be online, but they were telling them and warning them, hey, it's not looking good for us to be fully in person or even hybrid. So here's what we want to give you as an option. And to study online for the first semester, take a deferment for a semester or a year, giving students options, because the reality of being physically able to get here in the fall isn't going to be there for a greater majority of international students.
And kind of based on what you were saying, so you said the embassies started opening in July. I heard October was when they were going to open. So I think, and I've heard that from other institutions. So to me, it sounds like there's a lot of, I think for people in international education, a lot of confusing messaging to deliver to students. Because it seems as if there's some confusion coming from our government with all of these things. And I think that really leads to how our international students really trust the whole process. You know, I think the institutions already have that one kind of goal where they're trying to get students to understand their institutions and to see the value in their institutions. But then having this additional kind of hurdle, which pre-current political climate was already difficult, now it's even more difficult. What do you suggest the institutions do to relay the messaging, especially like, of course, going earlier on, but especially for those who kind of, their institutions made mistakes with getting things rolled out. And now you have your DSOs and PDSOs trying to figure out, okay, we have this group that's supposed to come, now they can't come. We definitely need to go ahead. And as you can see, like right now on the slide, there's all of these different things that are kind of in a international student's mind when they're coming to the U.S. So what should they do? What should that messaging really narrow down to?
Well, certainly it's a you hit the nail on the head here. It's a trust issue that they don't know who necessarily to believe anymore. But I think when an international admissions office is communicating with prospective students, you need to be upfront with them wherever you can and lay it out, say, hey, this is a very fluid situation. Our institutions are struggling to get to grips with how we're going to respond, how our larger community, how our state, how our nation is responding to this. These are all issues that we're trying to deal with, and it's not going to be the cleanest thing. And it's an appeal for some grace and frankly some understanding that that we're not always going to get it right, and that's just a reality of when things change outside our own control. We always we tend to blame the other person, right? It's not our fault. But to accept some responsibility as an institution, we want the best for you. We want you here. Here's what we're going to do to make it happen, and give options to students. And I think that's the key.
Yes.
But before, more than anything else, I think, and this slide here kind of addresses kind of my three guiding principles when it comes to communicating with international students, parents, whoever the audience might be, is first having a presence.
Marty, because I want to say everyone should have gotten a poll that just came out. So as Marty is going through his 3 points, I really would love for all of you to participate. Take this poll. We want to know how you've been providing reassurance to international students. So select all the things that worked for you all that you have been doing. And they might really jive with some of the advice that Marty has to give you. So Marty, could you go ahead and then y'all go ahead and take the poll.
Absolutely. Yeah, in terms of what I think every institution that's recruiting international students is, first off, you have to have a presence where your students spend their time. And everybody and their brother knows that students are on their phones. They're on social media. They're on various different platforms. It might be different in different countries. Obviously, if you've recruited in China, you know they're operating on a whole different set of social media accounts than we have here in the US, or that are available and widely in the rest of the world and are used widely. They're on different messaging apps. They're on different photo sharing apps, video apps. They're using all sorts of different platforms than we are here. And in certain countries, it's still going to be Facebook. In other countries, it's going to be Line. In other countries, it's going to be Instagram. That's going to be number one, or not too many are on Twitter right now. But just in terms of knowing your audience and where they're spending their time, and that's key. And it's online. It's on their phones, too. And we talk about using phones and using communication strategies to get in front of students. And making sure you're testing your content before you send it out, how it's going to look on a phone, and having A and B testing on some of these things, messaging that goes out, it's a good course in marketing to do that. You know, you have those pieces built into your strategies, but knowing where your audiences live, spending the time and resources to develop that presence on those platforms is key.
Audiences, Marty? Sorry to interrupt.
Knowing your audience. Yeah, that's exactly it. Yeah. But in terms of priorities for any communication you do have, once you have established a presence, is you can't just be out there blaring your message 100 times a day and expecting to get results. Your first point of reference needs to be listening. Listen and listen again. And understand what the needs of your audience are. And that involves some behind the scenes kind of listening, and that's what we do. It's a passive kind of a skill, but it's one that you need to hone if you're talking about international students and parents. Is understand how, part of listening is understanding how your institution is talked about in the wide world. Not just your marketing department getting a list of where or what sites that you've been quoted on in the United States. You got to be, if you're on the platforms that your students are on, you want to know how your institution is talked about. What are the issues that people bring up when they talk about you? Going back to platforms like College Confidential, Hobson's product, there's still active, robust discussions going on there. Do you have someone that's on there monitoring those discussions? Do you have accounts like through services like Mention that can track how your institution is talked about on different platforms around the world? Are you doing that social listening to learn what people are talking about when they talk about your institution overseas? Mm-hmm. That's part of it. A part of listening, that knowing what the larger scope of discussion about who you are is. But it's also listening to giving opportunities to your prospective students to ask questions through live chats, through interactions with current students, all of those kind of things, to see what they're talking about, the questions that you get back on online inquiry forms that you might have on your site. Whatever the case may be, what are the mechanisms you're using to capture that input, that feedback, what the issues are, listening to them. The questions you get if you were doing physical fairs overseas, or now doing all the virtual events online, when you're hearing questions from students, are there patterns in terms of what you're hearing? And are you developing responses to those? So then refining your messaging. And that's part of it. So it helps develop you. Every institution has key points, key values they want to get across in their messaging. But you need to adapt those to the needs of your audience. It's not rewriting it or coming up with new values for international audiences. It's how do these apply what your institution is valuing, what it chooses to get across, what its mission is. How do the key elements of that apply to your international audiences? So that's a part of the listening and adapting your messages that is really, really
and
key.
Speaking of listening, I'm looking at these poll results,
yeah.
And I still find it quite interesting that 91% of the people do regular email communication. Now, this works. I know in my experience as doing international recruitment, this works sometimes, but I noticed what worked better was, of course, when we could do things in person, meeting with the students at their institution at a fair, and then being able to chat with them in a messaging app afterwards. But email sometimes, especially as the impetus, seems to kind of get, you know, lost in the sauce. So what do you suggest institutions to do? Because email, yes, especially for official things like, oh, you got accepted. They're going to definitely check that. But what I notice, everything leading up to that, it's always a hit or miss. What do you think people should be doing, especially when we're talking about listening to the students and really seeing the ways they communicate?
Mm-hmm. Well, Kevin, one of the things that I think is key to remember in any effective communication strategy, you can't be reliant on one single method. It has to be multi-level. It has to be multi-platform. And in terms of how you are conducting your listening, how you're getting that feedback, it's going to vary. And that'll in part depend on the platforms you're using in your approach to different countries. You might have an on the ground support staff in China or in India that can do a lot of that and have better access to the kind of fingers on the pulse of what's going on in that country and what the key issues are that they can help relay that to you. But how you get that across or how you gather that it needs to be a varied approach, because students don't all get their information from one place. But there is one exception to that, but I think messaging can be achieved on multiple platforms at the same time. That is clear and probably should be the guiding way of moving forward, particularly in times of crisis. But one area that I think a lot of international students want reassurance on is when they go to your website. And this I saw was latent happening for a lot of schools. They had, when COVID started impacting how classes were being taught for current students, all institutions got a COVID page up, and there was a banner at the top of every page, of the homepage or whatever, that said COVID-19 resources. What I didn't see a lot of is that on international student pages. They would have that link to that COVID page or a banner specifically for that. That's to the university-wide one, but nothing specifically for international students that have, as we've talked about, some very different issues in terms of their, particularly for incoming students, that they need to be aware of. Even returning students will have that, have some issues there. So the websites probably, they would all have the university-wide information, but very little information for prospective students. And I'm talking here about I-20s. I'm talking here about maybe the next cycle, about test optional. Everybody should be at least test optional for international students this year. It's not the case yet, but it should be. But if you have those kind of policies, if you have new deadlines for admissions, if you have other deposits that you're waiving, whatever the case may be, those are the updates that, if you're going to send it out in an email, it should also be on your website. If you're going to and shout it out across your social media platforms as well that are relevant for international audiences. So I think that's the piece that a lot of offices don't always get, is that it has to be multi-level, because not everybody's on the same platform and gets information and processes information the same way.
And Maria, I have a question about, oh, go ahead, Kevin, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead, Paul, go ahead.
I have a question about when you're saying before adapting your message to the international students. The schools I've talked with, they mainly bring up how there's a 6-month short term kind of emergency put out the fire plan, but starting to look ahead for 1, 2, 3 years down the line. Mm-hmm. What do you think, kind of in the sense where we were talking Cal State before, how they made the decision up front and gave them time to make the proper adjustments for the fall? Have you seen, as far as communication wise, schools doing that, looking 1, 2, 3 years down the line? And what do you think? I mean, it's almost impossible to know given so much uncertainty around COVID, but what do you think those schools doing the long-term planning, what's the benefit to that? And do you think that'd be a positive impact? It's another tough question for you.
I think long-term planning is probably the least well-developed part of international admissions and recruitment strategies these days. And frankly, we've been in such a period for the last 4 years of damage control that there hasn't really been the bandwidth that most international offices would have to start planning year two, year three out, just because you don't know what you're going to get next. I mean, there's been a series of probably 10 different things that the administration has done trial balloons on, from the initial travel bans to messing with unlawful presence to potential threats to OPT to H-1B restrictions to what we saw this summer with all the other back and forth with Chinese scholars and students that are part of the military civil fusion that are cause of what's so much consternation with the government on spying and intellectual property theft and that type of thing, espionage. So those are things that just are constant waves that are crashing against international admissions offices and how we respond to those. It's almost like you need a whole separate strategy just to respond to these issues with China. And then on top of that, issues that impact all international students. And then a separate one for students from these travel ban countries, that even though the travel bans, there were three versions of it before they got one that stuck with the Supreme Court that was approved, even in those countries where those travel bans existed, the PR of that is just is one of the first biggest negative things that came out after the administration took office. That happened the day after inauguration day, those travel bans rolled out, on inauguration day. So even though there were exceptions carved out in each of those travel bans for students, that they weren't affected by this ban, other than maybe I think Sudan initially, that they were all students were allowed to enter and get visas. The reality of whether they could still get the visas but then get into the country, that's a whole other issue, as we've seen with Iranian students and other students from the Middle East trying to get in over the last couple of years in high profile cases in Harvard and in California with some Iranian students. So there's some real issues there that those kind of things, when that keeps on coming at you, it's almost like you're in damage control on 365 days a year, because you're trying to anticipate what's coming next, or how do you long-term plan when you have an administration that's coming out with policy after policy after trial balloon of things that get thrown out there, and a lot of times it's just to see what sticks. It's really a challenge now to spend the time and energy necessary to do long-term planning. But certainly I've seen, communication-wise, I don't think there are a lot of institutions that are doing that right now in terms of 2 years out planning how their communication strategy is going to change. I mean, they're just trying to get back to some semblance of normal at this time.
I have a question from the audience, by the way, and there's some that are coming in. And again, people, please ask your questions. You're more than welcome to answer questions. As you see, Marty has a lot of information. So you ask a question, we're going to answer it. And the first one that came in is, what are some ways we can train our international teams, on the latest CBIS regulations? Which I'm pretty sure that's like a loaded answer, since the interpretation of the regulations seems to change very often. But what are some ways that you would suggest that people train their DSOs?
Yeah, I think there has to be some synergies between international missions, international student services on these kind of things. And even career services, I think, is an important piece of the international student life cycle that often gets left out. When it comes to impact changes in regulations that impact students, there was the fear this summer that U.S. Citizen Immigration Service folks would be furloughed from their jobs, that was coming all summer, that mid-August this was going to happen. It was pulled back, and they were able to continue their processing of change of status, of OPT applications, all of that. So that is really something that I think you look at for training purposes for staff that are dealing with this. Oftentimes it's not the training of the DSOs that's necessarily the challenge. It's making admissions aware on the front end what these issues are so that they can inform and be informed when they're communicating with prospective students that might have these kind of questions. Because oftentimes there's a handoff between admissions and student services on the when the I-20 is done. Either admissions does the initial and then everything else is done orientation onward by the student advising office or student services office. So that issue is it's more international DSOs on back to admissions than the other way around. Mm-hmm. But in terms of just keeping up with the changes, I know so there's a Facebook group called ISSS United on Facebook that is a great resource for DSOs and advisors just to keep aware of all the recent changes. Anything that DHS uploads on their updates on COVID-19 updates that they regularly update, any of the changes to regulations that impact who's allowed in, who's not, that's all posted regularly through this Facebook group. And it's a great way to just ask the kind of questions, get feedback from other institutions on how they're handling, implementing new policies on their campuses. But still, obviously, the final decision has to be institutional, and oftentimes it may be other levels of outside of the international office that have to approve changes if it impacts policy and procedure, and legal might be involved. Some of them can get very messy depending on the circumstance. But really, the messaging is really, you have to be on the same page messaging wise when it comes to immigration regulations, because you can't mess around with that, frankly. It's either make or break for your institution if that student gets the right message to be able to enter the country legally or return to the country if they're coming back from study over from being home since COVID hit, if they were able to get out. So there's a lot of variables that definitely need to be coordinated and get all parties on the same page in terms of who's communicating what and what that message is.
And we have another poll, by the way, speaking of that, of training on CVIS. So have you conducted additional training to your team on student visa regulations? Looks like the poll just ended. Oh, but it came up, which is great. So a little bit more than half, or almost half, of the people who did the poll actually have had some kind of training. Others have not. And there are some who they said that they have not done these kind of trainings at all. And kind of going back to what you're saying, it's incredibly important. I know at my institution, when we would do we actually had to do kind of a walkthrough with domestic. We switched to the CRM, which some people I think are in the process of doing that. We're on here. And sometimes we would have international students that would go through domestic because they were at a high school. They had their first F1 at a high school, right, in the US. So there was a little confusion with that. So having those were very important. So then even those who are in domestic who more than likely would not be working with international applicants, they at least had an idea of what people in ISSS were doing. And just say like, okay, this stuff is very complicated. I'll direct them to international so they can go ahead and take care of it. I think it's incredibly important. And it really, I think it's one of the many ways that you can create that kind of partnership with all the different arms throughout your institution. We had a little internal roadshow later to go to different departments, especially with faculty, with understanding international students as well too, and how you could create inclusive classrooms and all of that. Which I could say that for another conversation, but it's very, very important to do.
I agree. Yeah, because there are so many moving parts at an institution, that people that touch international students in one way or another with their work, that everybody needs to be aware. And frankly, as an international missions, international student service, you're the two most important offices in that mix. You need to be on the same page if you're not already one office, and in terms of how you represent to the institution and then your student communities.
Yes, and speaking of which, we all understand international students are incredibly valuable to our institutions. You know, of course, you see all these numbers on the screen. Yes, I believe in all of this. It's very true. These are facts. These are numeric. And Marty, I believe you would agree. These are things that you share to like the people in upper administration, so they fully understand all of these things as well. But also for us who are faculty members, us who are, of course, DSOs, all of that, we fully understand what international students bring to the table, which is all of their different expertise, their knowledge, and they really enrich the classroom experience for everybody as we're educating them too and bringing that back to their country. It kind of leads me to this other question that came in, because the US used to be kind of the leader for international students. And that's shifting. So how can the US take back some of the international market from its loss to places like Canada and New Zealand and Australia and all of that? What can we do?
That's a great question. And one of the things I think longer term, when we look at international education, there aren't any countries, maybe save China that and India, if they ever get their act together, that have capacity to grow larger than we are in the United States. US has always been, since these numbers were first captured by IIE with the open doors and back in the day, has always been the leader in terms of as a destination for international students. There was a time in the 90s, early 90s, where the US had upwards of a third of the share of international students that were studying outside their home country. By 2001, that number was down to 24%, and now it's around 21% of the globally mobile pie of international students. Our market share has certainly decreased, but our overall numbers have also increased. So the issue when people start talking about, oh, US is losing their market share. Yes, we are. But we still have almost double the number of any of the next largest country in terms of number of international students. UK has been number two for a while. Australia has been number three. China actually supplanted Australia as the number two destination worldwide for international students a couple of years ago. That's something that most folks don't realize. They know China sends the most students abroad of any country in the world, but they're also in the top three of receiving international students. They're around 400,000 or so. But many of theirs are short-term programs, summer programs. So they're trying to build up their degree program capacity, which is where the US certainly and the UK are head and shoulders above most of the rest of the competition in terms of students actively seeking out the US, UK, Australia for degrees. Canada has certainly come on the scene like in gangbuster forms in the last 5 years. A lot of that is down to they actually have a national immigration policy that is set up that is very much pro student turning to employee, turning to permanent resident, turning to citizen. There are clear and defined pathways for those that are overseas that want to migrate to Canada to come first to study, either at a vocational college or community college or a university, to learn a trade and then work and then become a permanent resident. That exists. Those clear pathways exist. It doesn't exist here in the U.S. in a clearly defined category, right? Because there are study to work visas in Canada that are seamless to permanent residency and citizenship. In the U.S., it's a much more convoluted process. My yes. family came to the United States when I was five from England. My dad came to the U.S. on an L-1 intra-company transfer visa.
Mm-hmm. I didn't know that, Marty.
Yeah, I'm full of surprises. Look at
that. That's some new thing. That's some trivia that I need to remember. Yeah. Oh, okay.
I lost my passport. I kept my passport, but I lost the accent. So I was only five. So. British accent for a couple of years, and that was it. By second grade, I was just an American kid. But what we had come in on an L1 visa, that's one of the visas, coincidentally, that in July, Trump put the kibosh on to till the new year. Right. No new H1 or L visas were allowed in. Right. So my family wouldn't have been able to come this summer if we were coming from England, even as an L1.
Yeah.
So
that's some trivia. That is some trivia to remember, for real.
That process, even though we came in as a intra-company transfer, it was renewed after 3 years. After 6 years, we could apply for our green cards. And then eventually, right before I turned 18, I was able to become a U.S. citizen, naturalized U.S. citizen myself. So, but that process took 13 years.
It definitely takes some time. It really does.
Yeah.
And with that said, students,
they don't come in as immigrants, they come in as non-immigrants. That's the visa category. So the transition isn't a clear one. And in fact, that's often what we hear from when we're doing visa counseling for students. This is an issue that they have. It's like, I might want to stay and work and then maybe settle down in the U.S. And well, don't say that to the visa officer because they don't want to hear that, because you have to show that you have ties to your home country. That's a whole other conversation. But
hey, you're coming in and leaving, and that's it. That is a dumb job.
Yeah.
And with that said, we're going to go to our trivia because we got 6 minutes left.
Oh, my goodness. You got to give away some prizes.
Great trivia question. And it's not about you, Marty, I promise.
Oh,
so why don't we go ahead to it? Trivia screen, where are you? Because I know it's time. Okay, Route 66 trivia. Which famous novel refers to Route 66 as the Mother Road? Is that Atlas Shrugged, The Grapes of Wrath, or The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy? Type that in. If you want that $50, type it in quickly. Hurry, hurry, hurry. Let's see. I'm going to see who is the first person to put it in. Okay, and it looks like Akia Anem. Grapes of Wrath. That is correct. If you guess B, you are right. Yes. So the very first person who did it, you will definitely get a gift card. Our girl Maria will reach out to you to make sure she gets your details so then you can go ahead and get that little prize. Yes, that is so, so exciting. So thank you for playing with that. And now moving on to our last thing. We have a few things to kind of wrap things up in here, some points. Paul, if you'd like to go through that, because my throat is parched.
Yes, of course. I know we're coming to the end of our hour here, but I think it's important to keep in mind to have a clear plan, over-communicate, and be nimble. The next 6 months, the next year, it's going to be ever-changing. I'm sure we'll be having a completely different conversation when the spring semester comes around. So to keep those three things in mind, we should be at least in a better position. And Marty, if you'd like to add anything to that as a little bit of a conclusion, by all means.
Being flexible and adaptable is the way to go right now. You don't have a choice.
And listen. That's Kevin's number one. Marty's number two.
That is definitely number one. I feel as if I would have not been able to do my job if I did not listen to my international students. I think I said this to you earlier, Marty, about 60% of what I know is directly from the students, you know. Everything else I learned through the way a lot of other people learn stuff for international work. And speaking of which, our last poll, what is your biggest challenge in communicating with international students on application process changes in visa policy? Go ahead and put that in. You could choose as many, I believe, that are a challenge for you. So go ahead and put those in, and we'll go ahead and talk with those and kind of wrap things up within the next few minutes. Hurry, hurry, hurry. I can't vote, but you all can in this. But I will vote in the next election. I hope you all are too.
Y'all better.
Yes. Let's see what people say. And it looks like we have the results. Woo! So it looks like 71%, which doesn't surprise me. The complex process itself makes it difficult. If I could vote, that would have been my number one, because it seemed as, and I think, and Marty, is that kind of what you've been hearing as well too? Like kind of as a big one?
Yeah, I mean, because it's almost a constantly moving target in terms of what the new rules are. So it's almost every other week you're sending out a different message. So it's almost trying to sit back, maybe let it digest for a second, and then realize, is that going to change, or is that something I actually have to do something with right now? It's not overreacting. I think is the hardest thing to do at this point, given everything else that's happened. Not because your nerves are already pretty much frayed with everything else going on in your personal life, with changes to work environment, changes to how you operate in society, and now you have to worry about your job and how everything that impacts your target audience overseas. So yeah, it's hard to get a grip on everything at once, definitely.
And then since we have a minute left, is there, what is a very, very, very brief thing that people could do to go ahead and relay complex information to students in a way that keeps them safe and they're able to go ahead and go through the enrollment process?
Yeah, well, I think that those are gonna be two different things. I mean, in terms of process, there has to be something from the top in terms of your office that, and the way that's communicated needs to be upfront, needs to be personal, needs to be done in a way that acknowledges that there are, it's a changing world and we need to be flexible in what we do. And we're trying to be as flexible in terms of our policies when it comes to test optional or admissions policies and how we accept credentials, all of that, different English language tests that you can take. All of these things matter now more than ever in terms of access, because students, I saw one school in Iowa today just posted something that they're going test optional for their domestic students, but not for their international students. They even actually said international students and athletes still need to take SAT or ACT. It's like, good grief, Lord.
They couldn't just have it for the athletes?
Yeah. Even though NCAA is waiving it for this year, they're still going to require it. And internationally, it makes even less sense because test centers overseas are even less able to manage.
Many of them are closed, you know, can't even, yeah, they're not ready for that, for pandemic kind of things, you know.
So the process stuff certainly needs to come from you in admissions, but in terms of the enrollment process and how that's working from a student perspective, I think that's where you can, that's where you want to and need to involve your current students in that. That can help speak the language of a current student or a prospective student that will help them understand what that's going to be. And oftentimes, if you have target markets that you're going after, hopefully you have your institution, your approach, your strategic plan has identified certain core markets that you're going to spend more time in, more money in, more resources in to access. For those markets, you certainly want to be having a current student from that country be a part of your communication plan at every level to help you better reach and better communicate your message to students in that market. For more broad approaches or countries outside your target areas, main target areas, you still need to have something that's student focused, current student to prospective student. And that's one of the beautiful things that I think it often gets overlooked, but is such a critical resource. And Kevin, we had this conversation earlier today about how important your current students are in the process of how much value they bring to the conversation in terms of helping prospective audiences and parents understand what their son or daughter is going to be experiencing as a student on your campus. So if you're not involving them in your communication plan, it's a missed opportunity.
Yes. And with that said, the moral of the story is listen to the students, include them, and then you'll do well. Thank you all so much for joining us. Marty, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you, Marty.
If y'all have any more questions for us, you can email either me or Paul. Marty has a lot of great opportunities as well, too. So you will definitely see all of that in the correspondence as well on how to connect with Marty, too. Thank you all so much. You all know because shared experience is the most powerful tool to choosing the right path for the student. You all have a great afternoon, and thank you all so much. Bye-bye.
If you said so, I'd have to take the things and go.